tell you what, the last couple of weeks have been just kind of a whirlwind in themselves. And just really trying to center up on what God wants and what God needs to speak to us about to prepare us for the days ahead. And here a week or so ago, I was doing an interview with a young man named Daniel Duvall for the Kingdom Intelligence Briefing, and his passion is the kingdom of God. And the word tells us that iron sharpens iron, and in that discussion, there's a lot in his book, Beyond the Kingdom of God, that we were discussing, but we just got caught just talking about the kingdom of God, and an hour and a half went like that. And never really entered into any other discussion of anything else he was writing in his book. And it just kind of rebirthed something in me and began to stir something in me. And the next day I was exercising on the treadmill. And I don't know what it is about me and treadmills. Maybe I need to stay on it more because God really seems to talk to me on one. And God came and visited me and he said, "You want me to show you something?" Well, I know not to say no. Last time he did that, I was on a treadmill, and he deposited within 20 minutes a teaching that took me over 21 weeks to teach called Priesthood of the Believer. And so I said, sure. And in those 15, 20 minutes that was left on the treadmill, he began to show me the kingdom and started in Genesis chapter 1, and he took me all the way through the book of Revelation. And it's all about the kingdom. If you understand kingdom, and if you understand it right, a lot of the arguments are going to end. You see, part of the problem that we have in people standing against the commandments of God or what this or that or all the divisions that we have is because people have been building their own kingdoms. Sometimes we call them denominations. There was a guy that decided he was going to be the bishop of bishops, and he made himself the pope. And he was creating for himself a kingdom and declared that he was the vicar of Christ on the earth. How many know God is not after land? He's not after territory. He's after the hearts of men. That's where the kingdom of God is established. And when you begin understanding kingdom, everything falls into place. But to really walk in kingdom, you got to die. You got to die to self, because self always wants to create its own kingdom. It wants to create its own idols. And God is saying, no, he's calling us to really understand. When we understand that really the kingdom and the understanding of it is quintessential to understanding all the Word of God. If you don't start it with kingdom and it's kingdom throughout, you're going to miss all the points. You're not going to connect all the dots. And so I think what God is wanting us to do, for us to be that remnant church, for us to be that remnant warrior in last days, we're going to have to understand kingdom, because we're going to have to move in kingdom power, kingdom authority with kingdom purpose, or you're not going to move at all. And so God is wanting us to do this. And especially, guys, we're living in a time that we can turn on the television at night and watch the news and watch Bible prophecy begin unfolding before our very eyes. You see, the truth of the matter is, with all the nations of the earth and everything that's going on, it really boils down to two kingdoms are at war right now. The kingdom of God and the kingdom of darkness. So I want to, like I always do, we're going back to Bereshit. We're going back to Genesis 1. All things start at the beginning, no matter what you want to do. It always starts back at the beginning. So we're going to go back to the beginning, to Bereshit. And we're going to start in Genesis 1:1. And I want to start this morning by reading verses 1 and 2. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved over the waters. Now, first of all, verse 1 is a complete statement in itself. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. Now, one of the things I want to point out is that the word heaven there in the Hebrew is shamaim or hashamim, the heavens. It's plural. In fact, the singular shama is never used once in the Word of God. It is always plural. Now, one of the reasons for that, the rabbis at least teach, is that since the splendor of heaven is unlimited, it is without bounds, it is without end, it's like heavens. But in reality, I think the Word of God teaches us the Apostle Paul said that he was caught up into the third heaven. And there he was taught by Christ. There are three heavens. Or I tend to believe in a multiverse, that there is, our universe is the first heaven. The second heaven is a spiritual demilitarized zone between God's throne and where we have principalities and powers governing things that happen within our universe. And then there's the throne of God, which is the third heaven. And so, but God created them all. You know, this is something sometimes I think is hard to understand about our God. How many know God's beyond comprehension? If he hadn't given us the Bible, we'd have never figured it out. At beginning, before God created the beginning, there was just him. And before there could be nothing, he had to create something, because nothing is the absence of something. He had to create time, he had to create space, he had to create it all. And so this is the God that we serve. And so in the beginning, he created the first heaven, second heaven, third heaven. He created the earth. But then something happened between Genesis 1 and 1-2. And I know there's some contention about that. Not everybody translates it that way. But the Bible says that the earth was void. Now, when you look at it in the Hebrew, was there is haya in Hebrew, which means to be, to become, to come to pass, to exist, to happen, or to fall out. And what's interesting is in your English Bible, it is only translated was 7 times out of the 75 times it's used in the Word of God. 21 times it is used come to pass. 32 times it's used as become. The earth becomes void or became void. 5 times it is has been. And 4 times it is came. And so really the majority of times it is used, it is something happening, something has come to pass. There was a cause and there was an effect. So here God creates the heavens and the earth and it's perfect. And then something happened and the earth became void. Now without form or void, that is tohu in Hebrew. And it means formless, confusion, unreality, and emptiness. Now, I've had some speculate that was just simply the creative process of God, that verse 1 is a synopsis, and then we get into how that happened in verses 2 and beyond. But if that is the case, then before the creative process took place, the earth was already there. That doesn't make sense to me. And it started out as void, and God had this, you know, created this planet void, and he had to kind of start from that. So there was an evolutionary process to the planet. I don't believe in evolution. Evolution is a facade. But what's interesting is in Isaiah 45:18 it says, For thus saith the Lord that created the heavens, God himself that formed the earth and made it, he has established it, he created it not in vain. And that word vain in Hebrew is tahu. He did not create it tahu. But yet in verse 2, we find that the world was tahu. Well, God didn't create it that way according to Isaiah. So something had to happen. And I believe it was the fall of Lucifer. In fact, there's some evidence that that fall not only affected planet Earth, it affected Mars. And there is a planet on the other side of Mars that all we have is an asteroid belt, and it was called Rahab. In fact, the Bible says it was God who splintered Rahab in the book of Isaiah. That the fall of Lucifer, whatever, maybe his throne was originally on Rahab, God blew it up. And he kind of jumped and hit Mars and ended up on planet Earth. And so something happened that caused chaos. How many know God's not the author of confusion? Tohu means confusion, unreality. God brings reality. The devil always brings what? Unreality. He brings confusion. And I think Lucifer's kingdom was fully manifested in the earth because it makes it formless, full of confusion and unreality. This is always what the kingdom of darkness brings, and what Lucifer would bring at the book of the end of the book of Revelation, if he could, it would be what we find in Genesis 1 and 2. He would like to absolutely destroy man, remove God from this planet, and this be nothing but a rock caught in darkness, confusion, and unreality is where he would like to take it. with not a trace of God's creation or God's fingerprint anywhere on it. And so we find the earth in that state. But what happens? God comes on the scene. And God looks at this. Now the Spirit of God is hovering over this place because God has a plan. And God says, let there be light, and there was light. Why did God start with light? I remember one time years and years ago, sitting in Sunday school, and somebody asked that, and one kid jumped up and said, because he can see what he's doing. Well, first of all, light is the container of time. We learned that from, so that right there is where God created time, and so carbon dating for this planet really doesn't work since it resided outside of time. Let Einstein wrap his mind around that one. How do you carbon date something that set an eternity before time existed? There were spatial dimensions, but there was not an element called time until God said, let there be light. But what I find fascinating, we start in darkness. God says, let there be light. And then he said, now that light is good. He didn't mention that darkness was good. Doesn't mention that he created darkness. But he does something. As soon as God creates light, he begins to separate light from darkness. That is a principle always throughout the Word of God. God commands, and that command brings order. It brings light. And the moment it brings light, it also reveals what is darkness, and it separates it from it. Because that's kingdom. That's why the two kingdoms can't coexist. Once God comes on the scene, there has to be a separation. And let me tell you something. Once God comes into your life and he brings the light of the gospel, there has to be a separation in your life. God wants to bring light, and he calls that light good, and then he wants to separate the darkness out of you. But we have too many Christians caught up in the gray. Because their theology refuses to allow God to separate it. Because only the command of God can do it. And when you write down the command of God, and you write it down, it becomes commandments. Just kind of wanted to throw that out there for a little bit. Now the commands of God, because when you look at the creation process, he begins commanding creation, do this, bring forth this, let this be separated, let this be done, let that be done. He is bringing forth commandments. What is he doing? The king is sitting on his throne, and he is bringing his kingdom. How many know today that although probably our president would like to try to do this, he can't issue commands into other countries? He can only go as far as where that kingdom or that nation is. And when you go back into a dynasty, when the king begins to order things to happen, it's bringing his rule, it's bringing his dominion, it's bringing his kingdom. And so we started in a place that his kingdom was not. And in the creation process, God is establishing the kingdom of God on the earth through the creation process, because it's all done through commands, which is what a king does. Now, unlike unregenerated man, at least physical matter has the sense to obey the commands of God. When God said, light separate from darkness, darkness didn't say, I don't want to. It had no choice. It had to separate. When God said, let there be waters, there was waters. When God said, let the waters in the atmosphere separate from the waters below, they didn't argue with God. They didn't tell God, but because of grace, we don't have to. It was the grace of God that caused them to separate. The commands brought about the kingdom of God in the earth. Now, later on in the days and weeks to come, we're going to find out that that theme also goes throughout the Word of God. Now we get to where God is beginning to make man. Let's jump to Genesis 1, verses 26 through 27. This is a pivotal point in all creation. You know, we look at heaven, and we look at the splendor of heaven, but heaven wasn't the crown creation of God. In fact, Mary and I were talking this morning after talking with Josh Peck on his book, Quantum Creation. He shows one of the ways of being able to understand fourth and fifth spatial dimension. They have a box, and if you would look at a box, it actually appears to be a box within a box because you're seeing it from multiple dimensions that necessarily we can't see with our physical eyes. And it just dawned on me. I said, Mary, I'll show you this box. It's a box within a box because you're seeing from the fourth or fifth dimensional spatial reality. And so when the prophet looked and saw a wheel, he was looking at a wheel that is caught up in the fourth and fifth spatial dimension. And what did he see? He saw a wheel within a wheel. Because he was seeing it from a greater dimensional spatial reality than what we have now. It wasn't necessarily two wheels, as he was seeing it with greater dimensions than what we have here. I thought I'd throw that. I thought that was interesting. See, there's more in the Word of God. The deeper they get in physics and quantum physics, the more we actually understand the Word of God. I like what Josh put forth in the beginning of it. He started his book on dealing with Gnosticism, because understanding quantum physics is not hard. What they're doing is they're choosing to interpret it from a position without God, and they're choosing to interpret it based upon Gnosticism rather than a relationship with God. That's where we have the problem. But let's look here in verse 26 and 27. This you need to underline, because there is a uniqueness to man that no angel has. Even the archangels do not possess this. Lucifer does not possess this, nor did he understand it. And we're going to find out next session that it actually took him by surprise and kind of freaked him out a little bit. I kind of like that idea. There's something on the inside of me that just freaks the devil out just a little bit. He looks at these humans and he turns to the other fallen angels and said, they're just kind of freaky. Because he couldn't figure them out. There was something God placed within him. Let us make man in our image after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and every creeping thing that creepeth on the face of the earth. And so now God repeats himself in Hebrew. This means it is very important. So God created man in his own image, and the image of God created him. How many times is that? Three times. It is the superlative. It is the superlative distinction of man. Just like God is thrice holy. The ultimate holy, the ultimate truth about man is that he was created in the image of God. Now let me throw this out, because I'm going to jump into the book of Revelation for a minute. There's an image of a beast that speaks. The image of God on the inside of you speaks. R.T. Kendall in his systematic theology says, even with fallen man, the image of God has been marred, but yet it is still there. And because it is there, man has a conscience, and his conscience can be pricked, and he can be brought to repentance because that image of God is there. That is the uniqueness of man. That as long as even that marred image of God remains, man is not without hope, because he can be brought to repentance and be made right with God. That's something Lucifer never had. You see, with angels, once they make a decision, there's no going back. And I believe angels have free will. If they hadn't, Lucifer couldn't have fell one third of the heaven. In fact, I think maybe a third of the counsel of God, the divine counsel that we find in Psalms 81, fell. There's evidence that there originally were five watchers in heaven that were full of eyes. Each one is like a different animal. And they're full of eyes means that they watched over and they governed the other watchers. But the five main watchers, one of them fell because he was in the form of a dragon. And he fell. And very possibly some of the ones underneath him were the 200 watchers that descended on Mount Hermon that we find in the book of Enoch in the Genesis chapter 6. You see, it's all connected. But see, once they set their will to align themselves with Lucifer, and Lucifer decided to rebel against the Most High God, there was never any going back. They cannot repent, nor can they comprehend repentance. It's one of man's secret weapons. You know, we talk about the blood of Jesus being a mighty weapon in our arsenal and the name of Jesus. But the most unused weapon is repentance, and it's one of our greatest ones, because you can't put the blood of Jesus over what you won't repent over. And pride in the heart of man refuses to allow him to repent. But God, in his creation, he creates man in his own image. He brings it to the superlative of repeating it within these verses three times. Just like God is holy, 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 man is in the image of God, image of God, image of God, spirit, soul, and body. I believe even though God is, it transcends time and space, and that he is a spiritual being, he is also a bipedal being, just like you and I. We have a head, arms, and legs because God has head, arms, and legs. He doesn't have six arms, he has two because you have two. Now, he may have created other creatures with all kinds of crazy stuff, but none of them were created in his image. They were expressions of his creativity and his might and his strength. And one thing I want to inject in here too, guys. You know, we call somebody that if they're black, they're of another race, or if they're Asian, they're of another race. That's hogwash. That's ethnicity. There is one race right now on planet Earth, the human race. But there was a time there was another race. We call them Nephilim, we call them Gibberim, we call them Raphaim, and they're trying to bring them back. And while the elite are trying to get us to fight because our skin's a different color, they're trying to produce another race to replace us. Because in that race, they want the image of God removed, just like in Genesis chapter 6. Oh, guys, you need to understand, there is no man and no woman, as long as that image remains, there's hope for salvation. I don't care how deep, dark a hole they've gone under. I don't care how deep they have gone into sin. There was an old slave trader that thought that he was at the end of his rope and there was no one worse than him. And then one day he found the Savior and he wrote, "Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me." And let me tell you something, if that slave trader could find the grace of God and have salvation because that image of God remained on the inside of him, there is not a soul on this planet that the image of, as long as the image of God remains, that they're not beyond salvation. But the Apostle Paul warns, there are some that have had their conscience seared with a hot iron. In other words, the devil was able to get them to a place that he seared off the image of God. And he's longing one day to replace it with the image of the beast. Because just like a coin, God's image stamped on us means we belong to him. You want to see the genius of Jesus? One day they came up to him and said, "Lord, now, we know we're supposed to pay taxes and all this, and what do we do? You know, do we stand up against Caesar? They're wanting Messiah to rise up and to come against Rome." And he said, "Give me a coin." Everybody knows this one. Render unto Caesar what is Caesar's and unto God what is God. But what we miss because we're separated from our Hebraic heritage, this coin has Caesar stamped on it, so it belongs to him. But what Caesar needs to recognize is the image of God is stamped on Caesar, and Caesar belongs to God. Oh, I'm about to get happy. Now God goes, now once God begins reestablishing his kingdom on the earth, he creates man, but we also get another glimpse of the process. In Genesis 2 and 7 it said, "And the Lord God formed man out of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul or a living nephesh." Now, guys, there's so much to examine here. There's not a lot of detail about how God created the angels. I figure he just kind of spoke them into existence like he did in bringing creation and the recreative process we see in Genesis. But man is completely different. Why did God take the dust of the earth? And why did he form a body out of the dust of the earth? Because it gives us the right to have authority in the earth, because we're made of this dimensional reality. And so he had to give us a body to express the dominion and different things he wanted to do in us. So here the rabbis try to mess this up, and they're trying to form their golems, they're trying to be like God. How many know you can't be like God? You always end up being like Dr. Frankenstein if you're not careful. God forms the dust of the earth and he makes a man. But look what it says here. It says he breathed the breath of life into man. And that at that moment, Almighty God didn't speak man into life. He first said, "I'm going to do this," but out of all creation, you're the only one that God got his hands dirty for. How many know the cross was dirty business? He told us the end from the beginning. He got his hands dirty making us, and he got his hands dirty redeeming us. At that moment that he breathed life into man, he fathered Adam. He fathered him. There's no place where he breathed the breath of life into angels. No matter how powerful Lucifer is, or the two that replaced him over his throne, he didn't father them, even though they are called B'nai Elohim in the same sense that he fathered man. At that moment, Adam became a son, and Almighty God became a father, and he became a living soul. Why did God do that? Why did God actually work with his hands when he made man instead of just speaking him into existence? Since man was created by the work of God's hands, there would be work for man's hands to always do in the name of his Father. That'll sink in, it'll about hit you halfway home, and you'll go, "Ow!" About halfway home. That's going to hit you. While we're fighting that I don't have to do anything, everything is by grace. Yeah, go ahead and get in the kingdom so that you can get to work. You're saved by grace. It's not of works, lest any man should boast. But man, now that you're in the kingdom and you're part of the royal family, how about getting to work? Because you were created by the hands of God, God's now hands want to extend through you to do something worthwhile as an expression of his kingdom in the world. Oh, I told you we're going to have fun on this. Now let's go back to Genesis 1:28. Have you gotten happy yet? I started out happy. We have more praise and worship services like that. I'm just going to get me a big thing of towels and keep up there by my seat. Kleenex are not enough. Now, I want you to notice something. God brings heaven on earth. He creates an absolute paradise. Man has everything that he could ever have. Except for maybe woman. Yeah, that has come later. He has to give some of himself so that he could have woman. And guys, it's been that way ever since. If you want a girl or a woman to become your wife, you got to be willing to give up part of yourself for her sake. I don't know where all this stuff's coming from, but there it is. But he creates man and he sets him in this paradise, absolute perfection, plenty, everything a fellow could need. I mean, absolutely everything, absolute, wonderful, abundant supply. Provision beyond measure. Because write this down, the kingdom, always with the kingdom comes provision. It's not a part of the blessing, it always comes with the kingdom. I needed to hear that because I've got some plans in the next couple months. I need an extra $5,000 to $10,000 just in the next couple months beyond our regular budget to do some things I'm wanting to do. And what I want to do in the next 5 years, I'm going to need about $2 to $3 million. And I'm thinking, until recently, nobody's ever heard of Mike Lake. I remember it used to be, I thought it was a major thing to raise $3,000. And God is saying, no, you're going to need a couple of million. And I go, what? Don't worry, it's my kingdom. And then when I saw this revelation, kingdom always brings provision. Well, God, if you just bless me. The provision is not the blessing. The blessing comes with the kingdom. Because God set this dude right in the middle of absolute provision, but God didn't call that a blessing. Looky here. He sets him in the middle of a garden in absolute plenty. And in verse 28, and God blesses them. On top of that, that's not the blessing. You see, the blessing God wants to give, and it says, and God said, now God is beginning to speak a creative force again. And in the Hebrew, these are commands. Be fruitful and multiply, and replenish the earth. Subdue it and have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the fowls of the air, and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth. This was the blessing. This was the blessing, not the plenty. That's why people can set, they're in Hollywood, they're up in different places, and they will blow $3 million that I'm needing to do what I need the next 5 years. That's one spending spree for these people. Sometimes they'll buy one thing for that, but they're hollow on the inside. There is no blessing in the midst of plenty because they won't let Jesus speak into their hearts. Because only kingdom purpose, kingdom authority is never going to really bring a blessing in you. What made Jesus happy? I'm about my Father's business. Oh, that's... I just need to know what my purpose is on the earth. Start by trying to bring God glory. One of the things that Jesus said, he said, Lord, you know, when you pray and you lay hands on people, stuff happens. It's not like the Pharisees that make excuses all the time. You know, in the old days when Noah was here, and one day when Messiah will come, we're going to see a little bit of something. But right now we ain't got nothing. Jesus came and he was full of kingdom authority and kingdom purpose. And when he prayed, stuff happened. And he said, Lord, teach us to pray. Here's how you pray. You start crying out for his kingdom to come and his will be done. You want to start seeing stuff happen in your life? Start begging God, Lord, bring your kingdom. Bring your kingdom. Bring your kingdom. Let your will be done in this earthen vessel, just like if I was standing in heaven. I want to be so connected to heaven when you say move, I move because I'm doing kingdom. And see, that can take over where you work at. When I was talking to Daniel, we were talking about how marketplace kingdom is supposed to work, that not all of us are called to ministry, not all of us can be preachers from the pulpit. Let me tell you something, I can't do what a lot of other people do in business and to create jobs and to create wealth, to bless people and to bring some order. I can't do that. But you know, they can, and that's their gift, but they need to bring the kingdom of God into it. Lord, bring your kingdom in this place. Let your shalom, let your peace cover this place. Bring divine order. And all of a sudden, people begin to move with a purpose. In fact, we see it in the Word of God that when it came time for them to build the tabernacle of Moses, we call it the tabernacle of the wilderness or the tabernacle of Moses, that all of a sudden the anointing of the Holy Spirit came upon all the workers, and they had supernatural ability to go beyond their own abilities. And what did they build? A conduit to connect heaven and earth. When Christians begin walking in community and begin walking and letting the kingdom of God go, I don't care if they're a police officer, I don't care if they're a governor, I don't care if they're just someone working on the factory floor, when they begin to bring the kingdom of God and other Christians begin to work with them, it will create a conduit that begins to connect heaven and earth. Because it will bring his dominion and his reign and his rule. And once it's there, then we can move in it. Now, isn't it crazy for us to constantly run after God? God, just please bless me financially. This, Lord, give me plenty, give me plenty, give me. And God is saying, that's not the blessing. Bring kingdom. It'll come with kingdom. It'll be there with kingdom. And this kingdom is the only thing that can stand up against the darkness. Now notice in Genesis 1:28, man is never commanded to take a dominion over another man. Only that is allowed to God. Even in here, if God would establish me as an apostle for some things he's sending me to do, I can't take dominion over your family. That doesn't belong to me. I'm a coach to teach you how to walk in kingdom so every man can take dominion over his household and begin to see it move for the kingdom of God and to train up his sons and daughters how to take dominion. Not for men to have dominion over them, but for them to have no king but Jesus. Oh, that needs to sink in just a little bit too. You see, the Greeks and the Romans, they all seek to lord it over other people. And Jesus said, you want to be great in the kingdom of God? Learn to be a servant. Because I'm serving him, it can affect you. But that doesn't give you the right to make me a doormat either, because I'm a representative of the king. I'm an ambassador. And so are you. Guys, today's preaching would have us believe that the blessing of God is provision and wealth. But when we bring it back into the creation story, we find out it's not. The blessing's the kingdom. The blessing are these commands of dominion. And it's always connected. These were commands of God. You have dominion. It wasn't a suggestion. It was a command. You take dominion. You multiply. You replenish. You do these things. I'm giving you the authority to do them. So connected with God's blessings and connected with this authority in the earth realm, the commandments of God, what we find in Bereshit in the beginning, the first thing it does, it brings God's kingdom. Well, how can it do that under the New Testament? I have to obey no commandment. You're deceived. Believe on the Lord Jesus and you shall be saved. That's a command. That's not a suggestion. If you don't do it, you will go to hell. That is a commandment of God. And without it, you cannot enter into the kingdom. You cannot be born again. Well, Brother Mike, what is all this about just, it's not by works that you're going to be saved. We find it in Acts chapter 15. that some rabbis invented something called salvation through circumcision for the Gentiles. That's what the Apostle Paul was talking about. To add anything else to that is to read into Scripture what is not there. So the commands of God bring His kingdom, His provision, His protection, and it delegates into the heart of men the authority to function in that kingdom. No wonder the devil so hates the commandments of God, and he has infected the church with that same hatred. You wouldn't believe some of the diatribes that I have witnessed on Facebook. How can somebody that says they believe in this book so hate parts of this book? It's like they want to take the Old Testament, tear it out, spit on it, and throw it away. Let me tell you something. If your mama don't slap you for that attitude, Jesus will eventually will. When the Apostle Paul said the Word of God is given by the inspiration of God is profitable for correction and reproof and fully equipping the man of God, the New Testament didn't exist. When the Apostle James wrote, "Receive with meekness the engrafted word to save your souls," he was actually quoting the book of Psalms that said that the law of God will convert the soul. I want to show you something in 2 Thessalonians. Now, you'll miss it if you just read it in the English, especially the King James Bible. King James Bible is still my favorite, but how many know that sometimes it's the difficulty of the English language is not as accurate as it should be? And if you ever sometimes talk with someone who has come out of other language groups, English is one of the most difficult languages to learn. And I think for the because it isn't as exact, that there are many that when you get into Hebrew, Greek, you get even in other languages, that they are so more precise and they're so more filled with meaning. 2 Thessalonians 2, 6 through 10 says, "But now we know that withholdeth, that he might be revealed at his time, for the mystery of iniquity doth also work. Only he who now letteth will let, until he be taken out of the way. And then the wicked be revealed, whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, and shall destroy with the brightness of his coming, even him whose coming is after the working of Satan, with all power and signs and lying wonders, and with all deceivableness of unrighteousness to them that perish, because they receive not the love of the truth, that they might be saved." Now, when you look at this, this word iniquity, the mystery of iniquity, is anomia in the Greek. And it is translated the condition of without law. Or, because of ignorance of the law, or violating the law, or having contempt and violation of the law, is iniquity and wickedness. In fact, when you look at other versions of the Bible, like the Amplified, let me read it here from the Amplified. "For the mystery of lawlessness, that hidden principle of rebellion against constituted authority." First two-thirds of your Bible, constituted authority. God created a system that is the only system of governance in the earth that was not based upon the doctrines of demons we call watchers. That every other pagan society on this planet is functioning by. That Washington, D.C. thrives by. That Russia thrives by. That China thrives by. That every nation on this planet uses what the watchers taught them on how to create a society without God. And so the mystery of iniquity stands against delegated authority. Is already at work in the world, but it is restrained until he who restrains is taken out of the way. Then the lawless one, the Antichrist, Another term for the Antichrist, besides being a replacement for Christ or standing against Christ, is one who stands against the law. Now, how many know the Antichrist couldn't give two cents about the Constitution of the United States or the Constitution of Russia or the Constitution of Great Britain? He doesn't care about the laws that are on the books of this land. There's only one law that affects him, and it's from the commandments of God, because it will always separate what he does from what God does. Let's just be real. The Antichrist, the mystery of lawlessness, antinomianism, to stand against the law of God, is personified in a character called the Antichrist. And will be revealed, and the Lord Jesus will slay him with the breath of his mouth and will bring him to an end by his appearance of his coming. And the coming of the lawless one, the Antichrist, is through the activity and working of Satan, and will be attended with great power and with all sorts of miracles and signs and delusive marvels, all of them lying wonders, and by unlimited seduction to evil with all wicked deception of those who are perishing, going to perdition, because they will not welcome the truth but refuse to love it that they might be saved. So if Satan is empowering this individual to stand against God's law, what do you think is empowering many Christians today that almost want to hit you in the face when you bring up anything before the book of Matthew? The Apostle Paul couldn't even preach to them. Peter couldn't have preached to them. The Apostle Paul basically had a double PhD from the school of Hillel, sitting under the feet of Gamaliel. And did you know that before he could have entrance into that school, he had to have memorized the Torah, and by graduation he had to have memorized the entire Tanakh, all the Old Testament he had to have memorized. He was a scholar's scholar. And everything he did, he taught, was Torah-based. That was his foundation. That's everything he drew from. And then he showed us Christ as the personification of that law, just like the Antichrist is the personification of being against it. Why? The command of God brought kingdom. The command of God brought order. The command of God brought light. The command of God gave dominion to man. And so the only way to remove those things is to remove the influence of those commands. Selah. We say, well, why is that? Well, because we're talking about spiritual law here. Well, brother, I'm so glad you brought that up, because, you know, spiritual law is what we have in the New Testament, and it did away with all that Old Testament stuff because that was just a physical law. But what we want is spiritual law. Oh, Brother Lake, you're finally getting it. Oh, you're so wonderful, you're finally getting it. Well, let me quote you the Apostle Paul in Romans chapter 7 and verse 14. For we know that the law is spiritual. The law of Moses is spiritual, because it wasn't the law of Moses. It was the law of Messiah speaking through Moses. But then he shows the dichotomy, but I am carnal, sold under sin. The law is spiritual. Well, then why are you trying to do away with spiritual things? The question we need to ask today is, lawlessness loosed in the church today? Do we consider the very law of God as something spiritual, or as something to be rejected and detested? Would the Holy Spirit or Messiah establish something within his called out ones that falls in line with the Antichrist? You can't have kingdom without law. You can't have kingdom without instruction. You can't have kingdom without commands of the king. And to say that the commands of the king in the New Testament is different than the commands of the king of the Old Testament is saying that God is at odds with himself and that he changed his mind. Yet very basic systematic theology, God is perfect. He cannot change. How can you change perfection? But what does it do? If I do away with the commandments of God, it robs me of my authority. It robs me of my instruction on how to move in kingdom. It robs me of moving in the best of God and opens the door to where I cannot separate light from darkness anymore. That's why right now, guys, blood on the altar, the Christian versus Christian war is going on right now. And why is it going on? We've rejected the instruction of God. And so the person that has an alternate lifestyle looks at you and say, you don't keep any of the commandments of God, why should I? How come you can take that commandment and press it in on me when there's hundreds of them that you don't obey? In fact, I've seen it on national television in debate. The first thing they'll do is say, you eat pork? That was a command of God. In fact, God says in his word, he's going to come back and destroy all the pork eaters. But you eat pork, but yet you tell me because I'm gay or I'm transgender that I can't practice it because when God comes back, he'll destroy me. How come you can disobey a commandment and I can't? Here's my response. I don't eat pork. I keep the Sabbath. I figured if we did it before Jesus came, when he comes back, we're going to do it again. In fact, in the new heaven and new earth, we're going to be celebrating the Sabbath even then. Maybe we ought to get around to doing it now. Come on. The feasts of the Lord are important because they're all about Jesus. And what Christian wouldn't want to celebrate something that was all about Jesus from beginning to end? That God actually gave. What's wrong with thou shalt not lie, thou shalt not commit murder? Because then you got to deal with that. You'll have no other God before me, and you shall remember. The only thing that we're ever taught to remember is the Sabbath and all the commandments of God. Remember the Sabbath, keep it holy. I don't want to. Oh, Jesus came to change that which was holy and make it something else. No, he came to change the unholy and make them holy. You don't need to mess with the holy because it's already holy. How about that for a revelation? The whole problem is once I start understanding the place of the commandments of God within the kingdom, all my excuses go out the window. And I've got to give up my own kingdoms. All my denominational distinctives that make me separate from the church down the road so that I can say, we're the church, we're the bride of Christ, and you're not, and we got it all right, and you don't because of these distinctives. All that's got to go by the wayside, because if there's only one gahal, ecclesia in the Greek, gahal in the Hebrew, it means the called out ones. And you can't separate the church from Israel because Israel was an expression of the kingdom. We're going to get into that in the weeks to come. God's calling. Guys, it's time for us to get in. You see, if we can quit being denominational oriented and all these different separation things oriented and all this antinomianism, we can throw it aside and walk the commandments the way that Jesus did. We can bring the kingdom. Well, Brother Mike, are you telling me that you can take over and push the Antichrist back? No, I can't. I can tell you that I can so mature in the kingdom and give the devil hell so much while I'm here that God's got a harpazo. He's got to rapture me out of here so he can get the devil. The rapture is not to get you out of here before you have your head beat in. It's because we have matured even as though by fire. And God says, they're done. And they're so messing up that the Antichrist can't even do what he's supposed to fully do until I pull him out, then I get to pour my wrath on him. It's not about getting out of here before you get your head beat in. It's because you've all grown up and it's time for a wedding. that bride without spot or wrinkle, that she has made, she has grown up, she has found out Jesus is not supposed to become the way that she wants him to be, that she's supposed to start lining up with her King and her Lord, and she's the one required to do all the changing, not him. That's what we see in the book of Revelation, where Jesus is standing at the door and knocking at the Laodicean church. He was wanting to enter into a ketubah contract for them, to, for that marriage contract. And after he says, I have prepared a place for her, and I've made a way of redemption for her, her reaction was, okay, now who have I got to learn to be to come in line with you? Oh, we don't like that. In my Father's house there are many mansions. Baby, you ain't going to see them unless you change and become like him. He's not marrying a hussy. He is going to marry a wife, a woman that has prepared herself and said, how do you act? How does Kevin operate? I'm going to have to learn to operate in that court. I don't want to embarrass my husband. How do I conduct myself as royalty in the court of God? And how has he revealed in his word that all this functions? And I guarantee you one thing that you will not have is a ham sandwich at the marriage feast of the Lamb. There will be no unclean thing there. Come on. It's time to grow up. It's time to put on our big boy pants. It's time for us to grow up and learn to function in kingdom. Because what I want, guys, I want to see waves of the convicting power of the Holy Spirit come upon crowds and them start accepting Jesus in droves. I want to see withered arms grow back out. I want to see healings. I want to see the dead raised because God said, I wasn't done with you yet. And so I'm going to go ahead and breathe life back into that body and give you another 30 years because now you got a story to tell, don't you, Bubba? Come on. It can't happen without kingdom. That's what Jesus brought. First, his first sermon when he came on the scene was repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. Y'all got it wrong. You have your denominations, the Sadducees, the Pharisees, and the scribes, and then the Essenes left y'all and camped out in the desert. I got something to say about all of them, but they're not kingdom, so y'all got to repent, is what Jesus did. And then he began to show us what happens when the kingdom arrives. And then he said, go into all the world and preach the gospel of the kingdom. Kingdom, kingdom, kingdom. I'm not a dominionist that believes we're going to conquer the Antichrist and just hand Jesus the keys when we get back. That's not what the word says. They've gotten so far off. Don't let anybody use the extremes and the nuts and the flakes to define who you are. Stick with the word. Well, Father, this morning we just thank you for your word. Father, I thank you that your word is not going to return to you void, but accomplish whereunto you have sent it. And Father, my heart's cry is in every one of us, Father, here, every one of us that would ever listen to this via video or audio. Father, bring the kingdom. Bring your kingdom. Open our eyes that we may see marvelous things out of your word, and that we would see Jesus, and that we would see the wisdom and the wholeness of your commandments, and to see who Jesus really is. And Father, allow us to function in the kingdom the way that we see in the book of Acts. Father, bring healing to every family. Father, bring restoration. Bring purpose. Speak the blessing and realign your people back with the word. We ask in Jesus' name.